Hello, Discovery Learners. It is I, Teacher Liz, here, your host once more for this episode of Ability to Learn from the Discovery Day program. It's Monday, so of course I have new observances, history lessons, animals and plants to see, a new place to explore, and of course some Spanish words to learn. And be sure you're logging in for the Zoom sessions provided to you every day by the Discovery Educational Team. So let's not delay anymore. Let's start the show. And now for our daily observances.
Hey, Discovery Learners. It's Substitute Teacher Andrew Lancaster here again to bring you some really cool observances. Our first observance is National Lemon Chiffon Cake Day. National Lemon Chiffon Cake Day on March 29th offers a bright and zesty celebration among the cake holidays. For a nice, refreshing spring dessert, chiffon cake is a very light cake made with vegetable oil, sugar, eggs, flour, baking powder, and flavorings. The fluffy texture is made by beating an egg white till it's stiff and folding them into the cake batter before baking. Chiffon cakes tend to be lower in saturated fat than butter cakes, potentially making them healthier than butter cakes and pound cakes. The recipe for a chiffon cake was a closely guarded secret for years. In the 1920s, angel food cake was quite popular, but a man by Henry Baker thought he could make them a lighter, richer cake. Though he was an insurance salesman turned caterer, he tinkered with the ingredients until 1927, when he came upon the perfect combination of ingredients and methods to produce an airy, rich cake that he was looking for. He kept the recipe to himself. He offered his services to Brown Derby restaurants in Los Angeles, which he catered to Hollywood elites. Until 1947, Baker was the only person to bake chiffon cakes. Baker's secret combination and methods relied on what bakers and chefs already know about cakes and leavening. The lightness of angel food cakes relies on egg whites to create lofty and airiness. Traditional cakes use baking soda or powder for leavening. Baker combined both egg whites and baking powder to achieve the lightness like no other cake. And yet there was one other trick up Baker's sleeve, for Angel's food cake contained no butter, fat, or shortening of any kind. Baker added vegetable oil. While today adding vegetable oil to a cake recipe is commonplace, but back in 1927 these oils were a new ingredient to home kitchens. His cakes continued to grow in popularity, as it did so did the variety of chiffon cakes he made. Then, in 1947, Baker sold this recipe to General Mills for an undisclosed amount of money, and well, the rest is baking history. And that's why, today, we observe Lemon Chiffon Cake Day. Let us know in the comment section below what your favorite kind of chiffon cake is. Technically, mine's not really a cake, but I love lemon chiffon cake Yoplait yogurts. Our next observance is National Vietnam War Veterans Day. National Vietnam War Veterans Day on March 29th honors the men and women who served and sacrificed during the longest conflict in the United States history. On March 29th, 1973, combat and combat support units withdrew from South Vietnam. Generations later, veterans of this time period are gaining the respect that was not so freely given upon their return. Involving five U.S. presidents, crossing nearly two decades and 500,000 U.S. military personnel, it left an indelible mark on the American psyche. Returning veterans did not always receive respectful welcomes upon their arrival on American soil. Over 58,000 killed never to return, the observance recognizes the military service of these men and women who answered the call to serve their country. They didn't make the decision to go to war, they were drafted back then. Throughout National Vietnam War Veterans Day, we recognize their service and the duty rendered by all servicemen and women of this era. So how can you observe National Vietnam War Veterans Day? Well, show appreciation to the soldiers that we have today, and always remember the sacrifice made by the soldiers of that time period. Let us know in the comment section below if you have a family member or a friend who perhaps served. Next up is National Mom and Pop Business Owners Day. National Mom and Pop Business Owner Day honors all the small business owners each year on March 29th. Small businesses are a vital part of the United States economy, and a crucial role that is sometimes overlooked. consumers can show their much-deserved appreciation by shopping locally at small businesses. Or, in times like COVID, they can patron Greasy Spoons or mom-and-pop restaurants. One of my favorite mom-and-pop places to eat is Imperial Burger. It's right down the street from my house. Let us know in the comment section below what mom-and-pop shop is near you. Our last observance is National Something on a Stick Day. National Something on a Stick Day is a food holiday that lets you use your creative talents. Once you get started, the possibilities are endless. Foods that come on a stick are fun and easy to eat. There isn't much that can't be put on a stick when talking about food. Soup might be a little hard, but there might be some fun foods that might taste great as a popsicle. Speaking of popsicles, that'd be a fun summer treat to have. Or maybe a corn dog or a kebab. Street fairs and food trucks have created a variety of recipes made to on-the-go stick form that take us from breakfast to after-party hunger, with flavor combinations that sometimes make us wonder why we haven't thought of that before. Whether it's a fresh or healthy, or breaded and deep-fried, menu choices are a broad, plentiful for National on a Stick Day. My favorite food on a stick would have to be the corn dog. There's so many different kinds. They even have a breakfast one now, with breakfast sausage in it wrapped in pancake. Let us know in the comment section below what your favorite food on a stick is.
Go ahead and comment down below and let us know how you plan on observing, well, these observances for today. On this day in history. Today, in 1959, Some Like It Hot, a movie directed by Billy Wilder, starring Marilyn Monroe, Tony Curtis, and Jack Lemmon, is released in NYC. Some Like It Hot is a 1959 American black and white romantic comedy film directed and produced by Billy Wilder, starring Marilyn Monroe, Tony Curtis, and Jack Lemmon. The screenplay by Wilder is loosely based off the screenplay by Robert Thorne in the 1935 French film Fanfare of Love. The film is about two musicians who dress in drag in order to escape mafia gangsters whom they witness committing a crime. Some Like It Hot opened to critical and commercial success and is considered one of the greatest films of all time. The film received 6 Academy Award nominations, including Best Actor, Best Director, and Best Adapted Screenplay, winning for Best Costume Design. In 1989, Library of Congress selected it as one of the first 25 films for preservation in the United States Film Registry for being culturally and historically and aesthetically significant. It was also voted top comedy film in American Film Institute on their list of AFI's 100 Years, 100 Laughs poll in the year 2000. It was also selected as the best comedy of all time in a poll of 253 film critics from 52 countries conducted by BBC in 2017. I've seen Some Like It Hot. It's a very funny movie. Today, in 1974, Chinese farmers discovered a terracotta army near Xi'an, which consisted of 8,000 clay warrior statues buried to guard the tomb of Chinese first emperor Qin Shi Huang. The Terracotta Army is a collection of terracotta sculptures depicting the armies of Qin Shi Huang, the first emperor of China. It is actually a form of funerary art buried with the emperor in 210 to 209 BC with the purpose of protecting the emperor in his afterlife. The figures, dating approximately the late 3rd century BCE, were discovered in 1974 by local farmers in Litong County, outside Xi'an, Xinjiangxi, China. The figures vary in height according to their roles, with the tallest the generals. The figures include warriors, chariots, and horses. Estimates from 2007 were that the three pits containing the terracotta warriors held more than 8,000 soldiers, 130 chariots with 520 horses, and 150 cavalry horses, the majority of which remain buried in the pits of Qin Shi Huang's mausoleum. Other terracotta non-military figures were found in other pits, including officials, acrobats, strongmen, and musicians. Go ahead and leave a comment below and let us know what you think of today's historical events. notable figures born on this day.
Our first notable figure born today is Sam Walton, born March 29, 1918, in Kingfisher, Oklahoma. This American entrepreneur is the founder of Sam's Club and the Walmart retail chain. He pioneered the idea of consistently stocked shelves with wide-ranging goods and products. Before he was famous, he delivered newspapers and sold magazines. He worked at JCPenney in Des Moines, Iowa as a management trainee. He managed his first variety store, which was part of the Butler Brothers chain, in 1945 when he was only 26 years old. He unfortunately passed away April 5th of 1992 at the age of 74. Wow, he founded Walmart. I like that store. Happy birthday, Sam. Our next notable figure born today is Scott Wilson, born March 29, 1942, in Thomasville, Georgia. This American actor is best well known for playing Herschel Green on AMC's The Walking Dead, after his Golden Globe nominated performance in the Night Configuration. Appearing in over 50 films, he is remembered for his work in The Great Gatsby, Pearl Harbor, and Junebug. He later starred in Netflix's The OA. Before he was famous, he hitchhiked from Atlanta to Los Angeles in 1961, where he enrolled in acting classes. He unfortunately passed away October 6, 2018, at the age of 76, but I sure do remember seeing him in Walking Dead. Happy birthday, Scott! Another notable figure born today is Maggie Bard, born March 29, 1959, in Fruita, Colorado. This American voice actress, who had small roles in shows like Bones, The West Wing, and Curb Your Enthusiasm. She's also a video game voice actress. She has lent her voice to video games such as Saints Row 2, Mass Effect 3, and The Lightning Returns Final Fantasy VIII in 2013. Before she was famous, she made her acting debut on the soap opera Another World in 1981. She was later a member of the comedy troupe The Groundlings. She is also a country musician who released the album We Sail in 2009. And another fascinating trivia is, she is the mother of singers Billie Eilish and Finneas O'Connell. She turns 62 years old today. Happy birthday, Maggie. And our last notable figure for today is Elle McPherson, born March 29, 1964, in Killara, Australia. This 80s supermodel was nicknamed the Body by the members of the press and fashion industry. She is remembered for her five Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue covers throughout her career. Before she was famous, she got her last name from a clerical error at school. She modeled for a year in order to make enough money to pay for her law books. And up until recently, she was the former host and producer of the show Britain and Ireland's Next Top Model. She turns 57 years old today. Happy birthday, Elle.
Happy birthday, everyone.
Come along as we take a journey to the place of the week. This week we are traveling to Jamaica. Yeah, man, welcome to Jamaica. Yeah, hear the music in the background? That's Jamaica's national anthem. Sounds pretty interesting, huh? As you listen, let's go ahead and take a deeper look at Jamaica's flag. Jamaica. It's fun to say in the accent. Anywho, this nation's flag consists of two green and two black triangles, separated by a yellow diagonal cross. The colors black, yellow, and green do have meaning. The color black stands for the difficulties faced by the nation. Yellow represents its natural wealth and beauty of its sunlight, and green is to represent agriculture and hope. This current iteration of the flag has been in use since August 6, 1962. All right, Discovery Learners, Let's learn more about Jamaica. Jamaica is an island country of the West Indies. It is the third largest island in the Caribbean Sea after Cuba and Hispaniola. It is situated some 100 miles west of Haiti, 90 miles south of Cuba, and about 390 miles northeast of the northest point on the mainland, Cape Gracias a Dios, on the Caribbean coast of Central America. Jamaica's official name is Jamaica, or if you want to be fun, Jamaica. Its official form of government is a constitutional monarchy with two legislative houses, the Senate and the House of Representatives. Its head of state is the British monarch, Queen Elizabeth II, and it also has a prime minister. Jamaica's capital is Kingston, or Kingston, and its official language is English. Jamaica's most popular religion is Seventh-day Adventism, and its main monetary unit is the Jamaican dollar. 145 Jamaican dollars equals one U.S. dollar. The current population of Jamaica is 2,732,000 people, and the total area of Jamaica is about 4,244 square miles. Sounds tiny, but it's actually the same size as the U.S. state of Connecticut. Jamaica's main exports are sugar, bananas, coffee, spices, and pimentos. And Jamaica's main money-making industries are tourism and sugar farming and production. Wow, Jamaica is a very interesting place with a fun accent to try out. So be sure to stay tuned all week long as we continue to teach you more about Jamaica here on Ability to Learn.
Wow, now that's a really interesting place of the week.
Here is the animal of the day.
Hey, Discovery Learners, it's time for a new animal. We're going to take a look at the sailfish. Sailfish are a type of billfish, like blue marlin or swordfish, that are known not only for their pointed bills, but also for their extraordinary dorsal fins that can be taller than their bodies in length. Sailfish start as tiny larvae, no more than a few millimeters in length, but grow rapidly during the first year. They can grow from less than a quarter inch all the way up to 10 feet and weigh upwards of 220 pounds. Like other billfish, female sailfish can be larger than the males, so they can carry as many eggs as possible. Sailfish eat a wide variety of prey. When they're very young, they eat tiny zooplankton. Their prey will increase in size as they do. As adults, they eat fairly large bony fish, crustaceans, and squid. Sailfish work together using their dorsal fins to create a barrier around their prey in order to feed on smaller schooling fish such as sardines and anchovies. Sailfish are eaten too, by a wide variety of predators in fact. When newly hatched, sailfish are preyed on by other fishes that specialize in eating plankton. The size of their predators increase as they grow just like them. And adult sailfish are not eaten by anything other than large predatory fish like open water shark species, orcas, dolphinfish, also known as mahi-mahi. They're also a very fast fish. Sailfish are considered the fastest fish in the sea, reaching top speeds of 70 miles per hour. The largest sailfish ever caught was 11.2 feet and weighed 220.5 pounds. A sailfish can live 13 to 15 years. However, sailfish caught and released by sport fishermen have an average lifespan of only 4 to 5. While sailfish spend their entire lives near the surface of the ocean, they can dive up to 1,150 feet under to find their food. Sailfish are really interesting. I grew up around fishermen, and I honestly didn't know there was anything other than a marlin. Did you learn any cool facts about sailfish today? Let us know in the comment section below what you might have learned.
So what do you think of today's animal? Is it cute? Is it creepy? Go ahead and let us know what you think in the comment section below.
The plant of the day.
Today's plant is the hickory tree. Hickory is a type of deciduous tree that belongs to the walnut family. There are 18 species of hickory. 15 species are native to North America and Canada, while the remaining 3 originate from Asia. Hickory grows in floodplains and evergreens and deciduous forests. It requires rich, well-drained soil and full sun for optimal growth. Hickory is the most cultivated as a source of high-quality wood. Some species of hickory produce edible, tasty nuts. Hickory trees can reach 80 to 100 feet in height. It develops 39 to 75 feet wide of the crown and 2 to 6.6 feet wide of the trunk. Hickory has gray or brown, deeply furrowed bark. Hickory trees bloom during the spring. Hickory is a wind-pollinated plant that cannot perform self-pollination. That means the pollen needs to be exchanged between two hickory trees in order to ensure successful pollination. Shagbark hickory, shellbark hickory, mockernut hickory, and pecans are types of hickory that produce edible nuts. Hickory nuts are an excellent source of dietary fibers, monounsaturated fatty acids, vitamins of the B group, and minerals such as magnesium, zinc, and phosphorus. Hickory nuts can be consumed as a snack or as an ingredient in various sweet desserts and industrial candies. The bark of the shagbark hickory is used for the production of edible syrups. Pecans are especially popular and beneficial for human health. Regular consumption of pecans can prevent the development of gallstones in females and aid in the lowering of blood cholesterol levels. Pecans are also beneficial for the health of nervous tissue and muscle tissue. They can prevent neuromuscular degeneration. Many forest animals, such as the woodpecker, wild turkeys, chipmunks, beavers, forest mice, and deer, eat the bark and leaves and fruit of hickory. Those that feed on fruit facilitate dispersal of seed. The wood of the hickory is dense, hard, and durable. It was used for the manufacturing of airplanes in the past. Today, hickory has had the application in the industry of tool handles, paddles, drumsticks, and furniture. Hickory is also used for smoking meat due to the specific aroma of its wood. Hickory trees can survive a few hundred years in the wild. Pecan trees bear fruit even at the age of 300 years old. That's super old. Also, did you learn any cool facts about the pecan trees and hickory? Let us know how you say pecans, or is it pecans?
It's that time again. We just learned about a new plant. So go ahead and tell us what you think in the comment section below.
And now for the word of the day. Today's word is groove. It's a noun. It means a long, narrow cut or depression, especially one made to guide motion or receive a corresponding ridge. As a verb, it means to dance or listen to popular or jazz music, especially with an insistent rhythm. Groove. Our next word is a word you may have heard somewhere in today's video. That word is veteran. It's a noun. It means a person who has a long experience in a particular field. A person who has served in the military. Veteran.
Hola, Discovery Learners. Soy yo, tu maestra Liz.
Hello, Discovery Learners. It is I, your teacher Liz.
And ese es tu español, la palabra de la semana.
What that means is, here's your Spanish word of the week.
Su palabra para esa semana es calcetines. 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 Which means socks. Calcetines. Socks. Calcetines, which means socks. You could use this word in a phrase. Tus calcetines no coinciden. Tus calcetines no coinciden. Which means your socks don't match. Tus calcetines no coinciden. Your socks don't match. Tus calcetines no coinciden. Your socks don't match. Go ahead and practice speaking Spanish all week long by saying calcetines for socks or tus calcetines no coinciden. Your socks don't match.
Hasta la semana que viene, Discovery Learners. Be sure to tune in next Monday to learn another Spanish word of the week right here on Ability to Learn.
Hey, Discovery Learners, it's me, Andrew Lancaster. Yesterday was Passover and this Sunday's Easter, so why not take a look at these holiday classics? First up,
is Prince of Egypt. This PG animated musical from 1998 has a 1 hour and 40 minute runtime and is available on YouTube. Next up is Hop. This PG family comedy from 2011 has a 1 hour and 35 minute runtime. It stars James Marsden and Russell Brand and is available on Netflix. Up next is a Disney classic, The Hunchback of Notre Dame. This G film from 1996 is a musical drama with a 1 hour and 30 minute runtime. It stars Demi Moore and Jason Alexander and is available on Disney Plus. Next up is The Ten Commandments. This G film from 1956 is a drama epic with a 3 hour and 40 minute runtime. It stars Charlton Heston and Yul Brynner and can be found on YouTube.
Let's take a deeper look at this cinematic work of art.
This week's cinematic work of art is Jesus Christ Superstar. It was directed by Norman Jewison. It stars Ted Neely as Jesus and Carl Anderson as Judas. The movie was adapted from the Andrew Lloyd Webber play, Jesus Christ Superstar. A personal favorite of mine, and not just because it's a musical, but because it's a movie translated from a Broadway musical to the silver screen, and it did so without losing any of the magic it had on the stage. The songs weren't altered, so fans of the stage could also sing along. Rather than make it feel like a period piece, they tailored it to the time, with the disciples wearing things like bell-bottoms and crop tops. The film makes the world seem like a stage, and you are in the live audience. Being able to watch this on stage and then on TV makes you feel like you're seeing it for the first time. It's phenomenal. You can get lost in the amazing musical numbers and watch the story of Jesus and Judas and the other disciples unfold in a both new and familiar way. Judas is often vilified in the telling of this story, but as the narrator, you get to see a unique perspective. The pageantry and dance numbers are timeless. All these elements put together make this film a cinematic work of art you can enjoy again and again. This G film from 1973 is a musical drama with a 1 hour and 48 minute runtime. It can be found on YouTube.
Here is today's interesting fact.
Did you know? The origin of jelly beans is kind of a mystery, but they're thought to be a descendant of Turkish delight or Jordan almonds. The modern-day jelly bean was promoted to Union soldiers during the Civil War. To create the hard outer shell of a jelly bean and keep its inside gooey, a process is used called panning. In the early 20th century, jelly bean was slang term for a man who put forth great effort to dress stylish. Jelly beans became a regular penny candy in the 1900s, and were the first confection to be sold by weight rather than by price. Each color of jelly bean used to be sold separately, rather than a mixed lot bag. Jelly beans were President Reagan's favorite candy, and for his first inauguration, 7,000 pounds of jelly beans were ordered and distributed. Jelly beans created a new flavor, blueberry, specifically for the event. It can take anywhere from 7 to 21 days to make a jelly bean. In 35 jelly beans, there are about 130 calories and 37 grams of sugar. Most assortments of jelly beans include 8 different flavors. In the 1930s, Easter became the most popular time for jelly bean consumption. There are 16 billion jelly beans manufactured solely for Easter. That's enough jelly beans to circle the Earth 3 times. Did you guys know that, Discovery Learners? I just love jelly beans. I didn't know they were an Easter treat. Let us know in the comment section below what favorite jelly bean color you have.
Aw, we all know what that song means. It means we reached the end of today's episode of Ability to Learn. I had fun, and I hope you had fun too. But not only had fun, I hope you learned something as well.
Don't forget to hit like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon so you're notified for all the fun here on Ability to Learn from the Discovery Day program.
This is Teacher Liz signing out. Farewell, Discovery Learners. I will see you next time.